Dear friends, ladies and gentlemen, good evening. On behalf of the Indian College of Anesthesiologists, I take immense pleasure to invite you for this high-end webinar based on cardiac anesthesia, but which is applicable to general anesthesia practice as well. As you may be aware, Indian College of Anesthesiologists started as a academic wing of Indian Society of Anesthesiologists, but now Indian College of Anesthesiology is independently running institution and running a lot of academic programs to benefit the interested people and attract the youngsters towards this specialty. Today's program will be moderated by Dr. Uday Gandhe and Dr. Arun Maheshwari. As you all of you know, Dr. Uday Gandhe is one of the leading cardiac anesthesiologists in the country, and he is currently practicing in Mumbai. And Arun Maheshwari is from Delhi, so one of the best institutions in India, the Gangaram Hospital. And we have panelists and the faculty members. And I request Dr. Uday Gandhe to take over and do the proceedings. And the participants, please note that the discussion will be at the end of the session. And I request you to put all your comments and any questions in the chat box, which we will address it at the end of the sessions. And I also request you to keep the all the participants keep the audio in the mute mode and video also shut off, so that the quality of transmission will be the best. With these few introductory words, I will request Dr. Uday Gandhe to take over the proceedings, and Arun Maheshwari will be with him to conduct the proceedings. Thank you very much for joining us.
Thank you, sir. Good evening, everyone. So we have a very good going to have a very good evening and session on different topics in this webinar. We have three panelists and three very good speakers. I will first like to invite all three panelists to join this gathering. So Dr. Kritika Anand will be joining in sometimes, as Dr. Murli has said. She is joining from US. She is assistant professor anesthesia at the University of Minnesota. She is MD anesthesiology from AIIMS Delhi, and then pediatric anesthesiology from Children's Hospital Philadelphia, USA. So she'll be joining in sometime. Our other panelist is Dr. Neeti Makhija. She is from AIIMS Delhi. She is keen interest in cardiac anesthesiology and anesthesia for pediatric congenital heart diseases. She has more than 100 publications on her name. Very active member of IECTA also. And I will let Dr. Arun invite Dr. Murli. Dr. Arun Jade. Anyway, so Dr. Kanchi Mulidhar doesn't require any introduction. He is whole and soul of this IECTA academics, a strong pillar. I invite him as a panelist.
Thank you.
May I now, I think we'll directly go to the first speaker. I will ask, can I request Dr. Shraddha Anthapan to please project the first slide. She's going to talk on physiology of CPB. Dr. Shraddha Anthapan is at present associate consultant at Narayana Institute, Bangalore. She is back in the past IECTA traveling fellowship and has visited Germany, her keen interest being management of congenital heart disease, aortic surgery, cardiac transplantation. And of course, she is very, very active extracurricular activities also. May I invite Dr. Shraddha Anthapan to please present her topic.
Good evening, everybody. I would like to thank the Indian College of Anesthesiologists for inviting me to speak at the ICA webinar on cardiac anesthesia. I will be talking to you today on the physiology of cardiopulmonary bypass. Here is an overview of my presentation. So all open heart cardiac surgeries, as well as surgeries on the great vessels, require cardiac or cardiopulmonary bypass. Additionally, a vast majority of cardiac surgeons also prefer to perform coronary artery bypass graft surgeries on a quiescent heart. And thus, the primary goal and function of cardiopulmonary bypass is to divert blood away from the heart and the lungs and to oxygenate and subsequently recirculate this diverted blood back into the patient's arterial system, thus permitting surgery on a bloodless and a quiescent heart or a functionally supported heart. So historically, the first cardiopulmonary bypass was performed by these two gentlemen here, Mr. John Gibbon and Mr. Frank F. Albritton Jr., who performed the first cardiopulmonary bypass way back in 1953 at the Thomas Jefferson University Hospital, Philadelphia, for an atrial septal defect in an 18-year-old woman. So, coming quickly to the components of the CPB circuit. So, blood from the right heart is drained by a venous cannula, and this blood goes through the venous line into the venous reservoir. From the venous reservoir, the blood is pumped via the systemic blood pump or the arterial pump towards the oxygenator that often has an integrated heat exchanger as well. The oxygenated blood then travels via arterial lines into the ascending aorta of the patient via the aortic cannula. So for drainage from the left side of the heart, we have various vents, for example, which are introduced through the RSPV or the LA appendage or roof, or directly in the LV apex or the PA to drain out blood and decompress the left side of the heart. We have the cardiotomy suctions and we have the aortic root suctions. All of these suctions will drain blood into a cardiotomy reservoir and then further into the venous reservoir. Now, additionally, blood is drained, also a small portion of blood from the membrane oxygenator, oxygenated blood, is pumped by the blood cardiopedia pump via the recirculation line. And this is mixed with cardioplegia, and this cardioplegia can then be delivered to the aortic root after the application of the cross clamp. So here is an enlarged picture of the heart, which shows the various cannulae in place. So we can see the aortic cannula distal to the aortic cross clamp, the venous cannula, which here is a two-stage venous cannula for the RENSVC. There's also a retrograde cardioplegia cannula in place, which goes into the coronary sinus, and antegrade cardioplegia cannula, which is proximal to the aortic cross clamp. And we can also see the various vents in place, the left ventricular vent, which here is going through the RSPV, and the aortic root vent is usually with a Y connector over the antegrade cardioplegia cannula. So now talking about two important components of the CPB circuit. First is the systemic or the arterial pump. So there are two types of systemic pumps available. One is the centrifugal pump, which consists of a nest of smooth plastic cones or a veined impeller inside a plastic housing. And the other is a roller pump, which consists of two roller heads configured at 180 degree angle to each other with a horseshoe shaped backing plate or raised lid. And what this arterial pump does basically is provides cardiac output when the patient is on cardiopulmonary bypass. So how does a centrifugal pump work? So high speed revolutions at 2000 to 3000 RPM from a reusable motor are magnetically coupled with a series of plastic cones that are inside the disposable unit. And what this does is it produces a pressure differential across the motor, and this produces the forward flow of blood. So as we see that the centrifugal pump is a non-occlusive kinetic pump, its output is inversely proportional to the afterload, is not directly related to the RPM of the pump, and it requires a flow meter to measure. So one disadvantage of this kind of pump is that if the motor is switched off and the arterial line is not clamped, this centrifugal pump will cause a retrograde flow of blood out of the aorta. Coming to the roller pump. So in the roller pump, there is a sequential compression of the CPB circuit tubing by the pump roller head against the backing plate or the raceway, and this produces the forward flow of blood. So here we see that the roller pump is an occlusive pump. The output is equal to the RPM into the volume per revolution, and the volume per revolution of course depends upon the internal diameter of the CPB circuit tubing used and the pathway, the length of pathway that is compressed. This afterload, it is afterload independent. So one disadvantage is that if the arterial line is clamped and the pump is still working, there is the possibility of an arterial line blowout. And secondly, if we have an empty venous reservoir and the pump is still working, there is a chance that massive air will be pumped into the circuit by the roller pump. Now, between these two pumps, the centrifugal pumps are supposed to have lesser blood trauma, and therefore centrifugal pumps are the pumps which are used for longer CPB runs, as well as in long-term CPB circuits like the ECMO circuit and the VAD circuit. Here is just a recommendation. These are the recent guidelines by the European societies, the European Association of Cardiothoracic Surgeons, Anesthesiologists, and the perfusionists. They have given these 2019 guidelines, which recommend that centrifugal pumps should be considered for expected longer CPB times. Coming to the second important component of the CPB circuit, that is the oxygenator. So the oxygenators, currently we use only membrane oxygenators, whereas earlier bubble oxygenators were used. Membrane oxygenators could be of two types. So one, we have the true membrane, which basically it consists of sheets of silicone rubber, which are wrapped sequentially or circumferentially around a spool. And the second are the hollow fiber membrane oxygenators, which consist of longitudinal hollow fibers that are either made of polypropylene or polymethylpentene. So the polypropylene fibers basically can result in a plasma leakage out of the membrane if high pressures are used on the CPB circuit or if there is a prolonged CPB run. And this produces what is called as an oxygenator pulmonary edema, similar to normal physiological normal pulmonary edema, where the diffusion of gases will then be affected. And therefore, we have the polymethylpentene hollow fiber membranes, which do not produce such oxygenator pulmonary edema. However, they do not allow the transfer of volatile anesthetics across the membrane. And therefore, polymethylpentene, if used on a CPB circuit, intravenous anesthetic agents have to be used for the maintenance of anesthesia. So how do these oxygenators work? So the gas is let in through the gas inlet, and this gas comes from an air and oxygen blender. So the FiO2 can be adjusted by means of a knob, as well as the flow of gas into the oxygenator can be adjusted. And this flow of gas in is called as the sweep gas. And the sweep gas to the blood flow ratio is normally kept at 1:1. And the gas moves out through the oxygenator outlet. So this gas outlet, we can note, is also used for scavenging. Especially right now during the COVID times, we do use scavenging for all the gas outlets on CPB oxygenator outlets as well. Additionally, this outlet can also be used for monitoring the temperature of the circuit. It can be used for monitoring the volatile gas concentrations as well by attaching your sampling line to this oxygenator outlet. The blood moves in and out in a countercurrent fashion as compared to the air, as compared to the gas, and the exchange of gases takes place by diffusion. So in this way, your pump oxygenator results in alveolar ventilation for a patient on cardiopulmonary bypass. Here again are the recommendations from the European group with regard to oxygenators. So microporous membrane oxygenators are recommended as the first choice for use on CPV. It is also recommended that there is a continuous supply of oxygen, air, and carbon dioxide with backup cylinders for CPV. And yes, also a scavenging system is recommended for oxygenator outlets. These are all class 1 recommendations. Coming to the next part of the presentation, which is the pathophysiology of CPV. So CPV or ECC, we have to note, is a physiologic trespass against the patient. And why is that? It is because there are alterations of pulsatility, blood flow patterns, and pressure. There is exposure of the blood to non-physiological surfaces and shear stresses, hemodilution, a systemic stress response, varying degrees of hypo and hyperthermia, ischemia and reperfusion, also a reinfusion of shed blood and transfusion of blood products, and microemboli, both gas as well as particulate matter. So CPV as a perfusion system. The first thing we consider is the systemic blood flow. So the systemic blood flow on CPV is basically determined by the pump flow. So, and this is guided by the patient BSA, the core temperature, the hematocrit, the patient age, as well as the depth of anesthesia. So as we see on the normogram here, it shows the oxygen consumption against the perfusion flow rate at different temperatures. So we see that as the temperature decreases, the oxygen consumption decreases, and therefore the perfusion flow rates can be kept at a lower value. So at 37 degrees centigrade, which is normothermia, and a hematocrit of around 24%, the perfusion flow rate is the same as the cardiac index in a normal patient, which would be around 2.2 to 2.4 liter per minute per meter square. As the temperature decreases to say around 28 degrees Celsius, this perfusion flow rate can now come down to 1.5 liter per minute per meter square BSA. The other determining factors, like the depth of anesthesia, obviously as the depth of anesthesia increases, the perfusion flow rate can come down since the metabolic requirements are reduced. And as the hematocrit decreases, the perfusion flow rate has to go up so that the oxygen delivery is maintained. Now, the maximum flow rate on CPV is limited by the venous return, the capacity of the heart-lung machine, and the placement resistance and size of the arterial cannula. Here are European Society recommendations, which say that the pump flow rate has to be determined prior to the initiation of CPV on the basis of the patient BSA and the planned temperature that the temperature that is planned on CPV. And in case of obese patients, it is the lean mass which is used for the calculation of BSA. Now, the adequacy of the pump flow is determined by various oxygenation and metabolic parameters. I will come to that a little later. Now, the second aspect of CPV as perfusion is the arterial pressure. We know that arterial pressure is a product of the pump flow into the systemic vascular resistance. This systemic vascular resistance is determined by the blood viscosity, which is determined by the hematocrit and the temperature, and the smooth muscle tone, which is determined by the pulsatility, the sympathetic nervous system activity, the depth of anesthesia, the presence of catecholamines, angiotensin, vasopressin, nitric oxide, endothelin, the acid base and electrolyte balance, the systemic inflammatory response, and also the vasoactive drugs that we are administering. The microcirculation on CPV is also impaired because of various different factors like the precapillary constriction, the increased interstitial fluid volume, the reduced lymphatic drainage, loss of pulsatile blood flow, sludging in the capillaries because of hypothermia, altered deformability of RBCs, and the microaggregation of WBCs and fibrin and microalveoli. So here are certain recommendations for the conduct of anesthesia on CPV, since we have to consider the depth of anesthesia as well on cardiopulmonary bypass. So important to note is The oxygenator exhaust concentration of the volatile agents have to be measured. And this exhaust concentration should be at least the same on CPB as it is before CPB has been initiated. This is if volatile anesthetics are the sole anesthetic agent that is used on CPB. Now, if you are also using intravenous anesthetics, then their dosing remains the same on CPB as that in the pre-CPB video. And for monitoring awareness or the depth of anesthesia, we could use processed EEG like the bispectral index. Now, the circulatory changes during CPB, at the onset of CPB, we see a fall in the systemic blood pressure because of hemodilution and a decrease in the vascular tone. Followed by during hypothermic CPB, we will see an increase in the SVI because of closure of the portions of microvasculature, vasoconstriction, and an increase in the blood viscosity. There will be transient falls in the SVR after the infusion of cardioplegia solution. Finally, during rewarming between the temperatures of 25 to 32 degrees Celsius, there will again be an increase in the SVR and the MAP as we have increased the hematocrit by ultrafiltration and other measures. There will be a decrease in the SVR and MAP after the cross clamp release, and this is attributed mainly to the release of the metabolites from the coronary circulation into the general circulation, notably adenosine. So, to ensure that our perfusion is adequate on bypass, here is a small checklist that we have in the pre-bypass and the on-bypass period. So, in the pre-bypass period, we ensure that our anticoagulation is adequate. So, for bypass, we administer 300 to 400 units per kg of heparin. The peak onset is at 1 minute. At 3 minutes, we take an ACT sample, and this ACT should be more than 480 seconds. If at all we do not get an increased ACT after administration of heparin, we can administer additional heparin up to 600 units per kg. If still we do not get an increase in the ACT, we can consider heparin resistance. And in that case, we may transfuse FFP or fluid plasma up to 4 units. Then ensure that the anesthesia is adequate. Ensure that the cannulation is proper and all the cannulae are patent and all the lines are not clamped or the declamping of the lines are done. All the inotropic infusions are turned off. Monitors should be in place and checked, and pupils are inspected once before going on bypass. On bypass, what we check is the face, examine for color, temperature, pleothora, edema, and symmetry. We check the eyes for size and symmetry, any chemosis. We check the pump lines for the AV color difference. Heart is examined prior to application of the cross clamp for distension and contractility. The CPB flow, as I mentioned earlier, at different temperatures. MAP is maintained between 50 to 80 millimeters of mercury. If there is a PA catheter in place, the MPAP should be less than 15 mm of mercury, and the CVP should be less than 5 mm of mercury. We have indicators for global perfusion, so these are mainly the oxygenation and the metabolic indicators, like the mixed venous oxygen saturation, which is taken from the venous line of the CPB circuit, the oxygen extraction ratio, the normal venous 25%, mixed venous, of course, anything less than 75% would indicate hypoperfusion. NIRS, that is cerebral oximetry, is taken as a measure of global perfusion because the cerebral blood flow is maintained even at the lowest MAPs, the VCO2, as well as the lactates. Organ-specific perfusion can also be checked. For microcirculation, we can add mannitol and colloid to the CPB primes. A pulsatile flow is supposed to improve microcirculation. A hematocrit between 20 to 30% is maintained. Ultrafiltration, minimize cardiotomy suction or use cell salvage devices and other anti-inflammatory strategies, which I will mention later. Here are again the European Society recommendations for monitoring on bypass. So vasodilators can be used if the MAP is more than 80, and constrictors can be used if the MAP is less than 50. Otherwise, the use of inotropic agents is not recommended. For vasoconstriction, alpha-1 adrenergic agonists are recommended. In case of monitoring, the pressure, the arterial line pressure, both pre and post oxygenator have to be measured. Temperature monitoring is recommended. SpO2 and hematocrit monitoring is recommended, as well as serial monitoring of the blood gases. These are all class 1 recommendations. Now, the second systemic effect of CPD, the hematological. So there is activation of both the coagulation and the fibrinolytic systems on CPD. In red, we see the coagulation system. In green, the green arrows indicate the fibrinolytic system. And the two key processes being thrombin and tissue plasminogen activator formation. Again, hemodilution on CPD as well as consensual coagulopathy will add to this hematological alteration. Secondary fibrinolysis, that is when there's a feedback response of the breakdown products of fibrin to generate more plasma, is also seen. And thirdly, hypothermia, of course, impairs all the enzymatic reactions in the coagulation pathway. So obviously we know that at the beginning of CPD, we have to administer heparin to prevent the coagulation by thrombin. Heparin binds to and potentiates the action of antithrombin 3, which will then inactivate thrombin as well as factor 10A, 9, 11, and 12A. This heparin is reversed at the end of CPD with protamine, which being a strong cation, binds to the strong anion heparin. For plasminogen and plasmin, we can give epsilon aminocaproic acid and tranexamic acid. So these are always given prophylactically and not as rescue agents on bypass. Epsilon aminocaproic acid dosing is 100 to 150 mg per kg bolus, followed by infusion, and tranexamic acid is 10 to 20 mg per kg bolus, followed by infusion. So for the hemodilution and consumptive coagulopathy, what can we do? We can transfuse packed red cells, also platelet concentrate, FFP, recombinant 7A, but this is all post-bypass, of course. For secondary fibrinolysis, we can give cryoprecipitate. Okay. Platelet dysfunction on CPD is also noted. So the CPD-related platelet dysfunction is because of hypothermia, the exposure to non-physiological surfaces and shear stresses, and the drug-related could be heparin, nitrates, protamine, etc. For the platelet dysfunction, we obviously have to employ anti-inflammatory strategies, as well as the administration of platelet concentrate, corticosteroids, and desmopressin or post-bypass, if this platelet dysfunction is not corrected. Coming to RBCs. RBCs become less deformable on bypass. Also, the exposure to non-physiological surfaces and the shear stresses lead to hemolysis. So, to prevent damage to the RBCs, we can use heparin-bonded circuits, minimize cardiotomy suction, as well as use RBC washer and salvage devices. Here are the European Society recommendations for transfusion on in cardiac surgery with CPD. So, PRBC transfusion is recommended if the hemoglobin value is less than 6 grams per dl. FFP transfusion prophylactically is not recommended. Here they say that in the case of antithrombin deficiency, first we need to administer antithrombin concentrate. If that doesn't work, then we can administer FFP. But the prophylactic use of FFP is not recommended. Now, a retransfusion of the residual volume in the venous reservoir back to the patient is recommended. It is a class 1 recommendation in order to minimize allogenic blood transfusions to the patient. And also a limited use of cardiotomy suction is definitely is recommended. The systemic effects of CPD, the inflammatory response. CPD triggers an immense inflammatory response in the patient. There is complement activation resulting in expression of adhesion molecules, the polymorphonuclear priming resulting in the thrombaxane A2, PGE1, PGI2, oxygen-free radicals. There will be cytokine introduction, IL-6, IL-8, and TNF-alpha. And the ischemia reperfusion injury also results in activation of the endothelial cells, like the platelet activating factor, endothelin 1, and decreased nitric oxide. All of these contribute to a significant inflammatory response on CPD. Majority of the recommendations in the 2019 guidelines focus on anti-inflammatory strategies on CPD. These include the use of heparin-bonded circuits, reduced priming volumes, closed venous reservoirs, the use of centrifugal pumps, as I said, they produce lesser blood trauma, RBC washer and salvage devices, the use of miniaturized extracorporeal circuits, a separate cardiotomy reservoir, minimize cardiotomy suction, and also filters on all the arterial lines, which could include leukofilters, the use of pulsatile flow on bypass, as well as ultrafiltration, including modified ultrafiltration. Here are the recommendations, as I had already mentioned, the use of miniaturized circuit, minimizing cardiotomy suctions, the use of a cardiotomy reservoir, and the processing of all cardiotomy blood. Coming to the fluid balance, an increased membrane permeability, a fall in the plasma osmotic pressure, increased capillary hydrostatic pressure, as well as impaired lymphatic drainage result in the accumulation of interstitial fluid on bypass. So the measures that we can adopt are anti-inflammatory strategies, the use of retrograde plus anterograde priming, and ultrafiltration. Ensure adequacy of venous drainage on bypass. And here are the European Society recommendations. The retrograde and anterograde priming of the circuit, which is basically allowing blood to flow into the circuit and draining out the excess crystalloid prime, is a class 1 recommendation for cardiopulmonary bypass. Ultrafiltration, I won't get into the depths of it, but the conventional ultrafiltration is basically draining out blood from the venous side, utilizing the systemic arterial pump as the pump to drive blood into the ultrafilter, and then that filtered blood is returned back into the venous reservoir. Conventional ultrafiltration is performed when the patient is still on bypass. This raises the hematocrit of blood and also reduces a lot of the inflammatory response on bypass. Modified ultrafiltration is done after the patient has come off bypass, when venous and arterial lines are clamped. The recirculation line on the arterial side goes through the cardioplegia pump, and that pumps blood into the ultrafilter. And this ultrafiltered blood is then returned into the venous side of the patient. The systemic effects of CPB on the CVS. So arterial cannulation can result in plaque embolization and arterial injury, resulting in myocardial ischemia or infarction. Capillary dysfunction and a prolonged CPB run can result in myocardial edema. Inadequate cardioplegia, ventricular distension, and prolonged ventricular fibrillation can result in myocardial stunning or dysfunction. And hypoperfusion and endotoxemia can also result in myocardial dysfunction. Here are the different measures that we can undertake: a TE or an epicardiac ultrasound to ensure that there are no plaques at the cannulation site. Optimizing microcirculatory function, as I mentioned earlier, by the use of mannitol, colloids, pulsatile flow, etc. Adequate plagia dosing, which is usually around 20 to 30 ml per kg at the correct temperature. We usually use cold blood cardioplegia in most of our surgeries. And adequate venting of the heart by means of RSPV vents, PE vents, etc. And ensuring an adequate perfusion on bypass, as well as the use of antibiotics and digestive decontamination to prevent endotoxemia. A class 1 recommendation is that the cardioplegia dosing be patient-centered, and there should not be a fixed institutional protocol. So in case of patients who require higher cardioplegia doses, for example, in hypertrophied hearts, etc., a higher dose of cardioplegia should be used. Systemic effects of CPB on the CNS. Again, arterial cannulation can result in plaque embolization and microemboli, leading to stroke or neurocognitive dysfunction. Hypoperfusion again can lead to neurocognitive dysfunction, inflammatory response, capillary dysfunction, and a prolonged CPB run. All of them can lead to neurocognitive dysfunction. The measures that can be taken, again, TE or epicardiac ultrasound, to prevent hypoperfusion or maintain an adequate perfusion on bypass, anti-inflammatory strategies, optimizing microcirculatory function. For microemboli in adult cardiac surgical patients, alpha-stat pH management. Alpha-stat pH based management is a class 2A recommendation for the conduct of cardiopulmonary bypass for adult cardiac surgery procedures. And it is a class 1 recommendation to flush the circuit with CO2 prior to priming the circuit in order to reduce the level of gas emboli. Talking a little bit about pH management on CPB. So with hypothermia, there will be an increase in the solubility of carbon dioxide, a fall in the partial pressure of carbon dioxide, and an increase in the arterial pH, thereby giving rise to an apparent respiratory alkalosis when the patient is on cardiopulmonary bypass. In the alpha-stat method, the crux of the alpha-stat method is the preservation of a normal transmembrane gradient. So with hypothermia, along with the arterial pH increasing, there is also an increase in the intracellular pH, and thereby the transmembrane gradient remains almost the same. Now, alpha-stat management acknowledges this temperature dependence of the normal arterial pH. So in the alpha-stat method, we maintain the PaCO2 at 40 mm of mercury and the pH at 7.4 in vitro, that is in the lab analysis of the blood gas. A pH of 7.4 and a PaCO2 of 40 is maintained, and this corresponds to a pH of 7.56 and a PaCO2 of 26 in the patient at 28 degrees. So we are accepting that degree of apparent respiratory alkalosis in the patient. Whereas in the pH stat method, we add carbon dioxide to the oxygenator inlet in order to maintain a pH of 7.4 and a PaCO2 of 40 mm of mercury in vivo in the patient at 28 degrees Celsius, which corresponds to a lab value of a pH of 7.26, PaCO2 of 56. That is, on the lab value, there will be an apparent respiratory acidosis. So this is the difference between the two methods. In the pH stat method, we see that there is an increased cerebral blood flow. So although this has the advantage of a better cerebral cooling prior to any circulatory arrest, the pH stat method, because of the increase in the cerebral blood flow, can also push microemboli into the cerebral circulation, resulting in neurocognitive dysfunction in adult cardiac surgical patients. Whereas in pediatric patients, we do see that there is less neurological injury with pH stat method. Why? Because brain injury mechanism in pediatrics is mainly because of hypoperfusion. So in adult cardiac surgical patients, the alpha stat pH management method is what is recommended. It also provides for better cerebral metabolic recovery after circulatory arrest.
Sorry to interrupt, just two minutes more.
Yes, sir. Systemic effects of CPB on the renal function, there is depressed renal tubular function, glomerular function, and there can also be renal dysfunction. The methods employed are obviously a MAP between 50 to 80, shorten or avoid hypothermia, anti-inflammatory strategies, and optimize microcirculatory function. Recommendation is that pulsatile perfusion is supposed to be better for the lung, for the kidneys, for the splanchnic circulation, and this is a class 2A recommendation. Pulsatile perfusion can be produced by reducing venous drainage a little by the use of IABP as well as some modification of roller pumps. And on the splanchnic system, again, there can be mesenteric ischemia, hepatic dysfunction, endotoxemia, bacteremia, gut edema. It's all the same strategies that we employ even for the splanchnic circulation. And on the lungs, there will be a decreased pulmonary blood flow because of macro or microemboli, membrane damage, alveolar membrane damage because of complement activation, etc., pulmonary edema because of capillary dysfunction or prolonged CPB run, and the lung deflation during CPB can also produce atelectasis. Here are the various methods to minimize these. Recruitment maneuver at the end of CPB is what we can do in order to correct the atelectasis on bypass. Here are the European Society recommendations. Biocompatible modifications of circuits, the use of modified ultrafiltration, PEEP during bypass can be considered. Ventilation during bypass also can be considered. These are 2A and 2B recommendations respectively. And the use of high dose dexamethasone is also a 2B recommendation. So in summary, the responsibility for safe CPB run is shared by surgeons, anesthesiologists, and perfusionists. CPB is definitely a physiologic trespass against the patient. However, the adoption of anti-inflammatory strategies and the maintenance of adequate and stable oxygenation and organ perfusion is key to avoiding or mitigating any adverse effects introduced by this trespass.
Thank you, Shraddha. So, nice presentation of a complicated topic. Physiology is always difficult to explain and understand. May I invite the second speaker for today, Dr. Deepak Gowde. Deepak, can you share your... please vote for this poll first. He is Dr. Deepak Gowde. Is Deepak, please first slide. He's done a fellowship in cardiac anesthesia from Jayadeva, Bangalore. He is a very, very active academician, I will say, of IATA. He's presented a lot of papers. He has won Janak Mehta in a row, I think 3 years in a row, Janak Mehta, prestigious Janak Mehta Award. Of the IACTA conferences. He also was on editorial board of the Eco Library. His main interest has been intraoperative echocardiography. Deepak, you can start your presentation, please. He's talking on application of Euroscore and STS risk score for cardiac surgery. Deepak, you can start your presentation. Deepak, you're muted. You're muted, Deepak. We can't hear you. You have to unmute. Deepak, you have to unmute.
Yeah.
Yeah, now we can. Go ahead.
Okay, so Mike. Topic for presentation is Euroscore 2 and STS scores in cardiac surgery. With the kind permission of the chair, I would like to add that validity or usefulness of these scores in Indian patients. So cardiac surgery has been very, very phenomenal. Development has happened in last 3 or 4 decades. And that is because every cardiac surgery which is performed has been very, very precisely monitored for preoperative, intraoperative, and postoperative factors. So one of the most important landmark in this risk stratification or predicting the risk has been the Euroscore. This Euroscore was introduced in 1999. It has served as benchmark in cardiac surgery. It has got more than 1,500 formal citations. So as the cardiac surgery evolved, in 2006, the log Euroscore was introduced, and the latest Euroscore, which is called as Euroscore 2, is available since 2011 to overcome the shortcomings of original score or to just be contemporary to what is the present cardiac surgical practices. The STS score is the Society of Thoracic Surgeons risk score, which is also known as the American score. It, in addition to providing the risk of mortality, it provides risk of various post-operative major morbidities. So when we assign a Euroscore, what do we mean? When we assign Euroscore, we give the direct risk of mortality in the same hospitalization or after discharge within 30 days of surgery. The STS risk score gives this mortality. In addition, it gives us an idea about the length of stay, prolonged ventilation, which is more than 24 hours, renal failure, risk of post-operative renal failure, that is dialysis or rise in creatinine, the stroke, which is central neurological deficit lasting for more than 72 hours, deep sternal wound infection, reoperation probability for any reason.
Sorry, so Deepak, just keep your video on, please. We can't see you. We can see the slides, but we can't see you. We can hear you well.
Just a second. Okay, so this Euroscore 2 was, this particular paper was basically authored by Professor Sam Nashif from Cambridge, UK. What they had done is they had developed a dedicated website which would collect data of all the patients during the 12-week period. and they collected data of almost more than 22,000 patients. And they divided that data into 16,000 patients who had a developmental data set, and validation data set was in another 5,000 patients. So this data was gathered from 154 hospitals from 43 countries. There was a very small representation from India. Four institutes contributed. From it was different from previous scores in that NYHA classes 2, 3, and 4 were added. The Canadian Cardiology Society Angina score 4 was incorporated into this model. The diabetes status, which was dependent on insulin or not, which was not there in previous scores, has been added in this. So previous scores had only serum creatinine values, but now they have added creatinine clearance, which is supposed to be a better predictor. The new model recognizes various surgical categories. It is very important to understand. Elective category means patient is electively admitted for that particular surgery. Urgent category means if a patient is admitted for some other reason, like if patient is admitted for coronary angiography and the cardiologist diagnoses a critical left main stenosis. In that case, we have to operate the patient in the same hospitalization. So that is considered as urgent cardiac surgery. Emergency cardiac surgery means patient cannot wait for the next day. So as soon as the OT slot is available, you have to take that patient for surgery. That is considered as emergency surgery. And salvage surgery means somebody who has undergone CPR or who has received cardiopulmonary resuscitation, that patient category is salvage. So this particular scoring, if you can just Google Euroscore 2 calculator, you can get it. So this is a snapshot from a very typical patient who is undergoing isolated elective CABG. This is a 65-year-old male patient whose creatinine is 1.5 and his creatinine clearance is moderately reduced, that is 60. He is a very active smoker, so he is having a chronic lung disease. He is a diabetic on insulin. His NYHA class is 3 with ejection fraction of 40%. So basically all these factors here, we have to enter those factors, and these are the log values on the right hand side. The log values are there. So for every factor, these are the log values. This patient had got MI 1 month back. So any MI which is within 90 days is considered as recent myocardial infarction, and his PA pressures is 40. Okay, so if we enter all these risk factors like patient related factor, cardiac related factor, and surgery or operation related factors, we directly get a percentage, and this is the percentage or probability of mortality after this particular surgery. So this is an interactive calculator which is available free online. So before taking a patient, you can just check this Euroscore 2. On the other hand, the STS score is heavily reliant on the STS, that is Society of Thoracic Surgery National Database. So this is one of the world's most premier database, which is available, which has got more than 6.5 million records with them. And this database has been started since 1989. And in this particular risk score, there are different log values or different importance given to various surgical categories. So you have to first choose a surgical category, whether it is isolated CABG, valve replacement, or a combined surgery. So based on the surgery, they give a risk factor. So this, for giving an example, a typical patient that we usually encounter in our cardiac rooms is an isolated aortic valve replacement patient, no CABG, a 65-year-old gentleman with degenerative aortic stenosis. So if you enter all the risk factors in this STS calculator, which is last updated in 2018, you get all these factors. So mortality risk for that particular patient is only 0.8%. His renal failure chances are fairly low. His prolonged ventilation is 3.2% and like that. So all these factors are directly given in addition to mortality when we do a STS risk score. So basically, why all these scoring systems? So how these scoring systems are important? Because they allow us for better risk prediction, better risk stratification. we can counsel our patients based on these risk factors, and we can take an informed consent based on all these risk factors. It is very important that appropriate referrals to higher centers can be done if the scoring system is very high. We can compare among the hospitals or the units in one particular hospital and help them improve. And these scoring systems are one of the very most important factors for quality control in cardiac surgery. So coming to Indian patients, so are we the same as Westerners, or can we apply these scoring systems in Indian patients? So this was the first paper from All India Institute. 1,000 consecutive adult surgical patients, CABG and VAL patients were taken, and they concluded that the mortality was predicted well in low and moderate risk patients, but in high risk patients, it was underestimated. That means the mortality, observed mortality, was higher than what was predicted. Our group also published this particular paper, and we compared both two systems, Euroscore 2 and STS score system, in 500 consecutive patients over 1 year of surgical time. The mortality was observed mortality was 1.6%. And a calibration power, that means overall model fit of this two scoring system, was found to be satisfactory in our study. On the other hand, discriminatory power, that is a power in which we can say that whether patient will have mortality or not, that was found to be poor. So if you get an area under receiver operating curve more than 0.7 or more than 0.75, that means this graph going more on the left upper side, that means it is a good discriminatory power. But in our study, it was poor. That was mainly because of the high risk population or high risk surgical category was not adequately stratified in our study. Another important thing, previous study had included on-pump CABG. So one of the commonest surgery in India still performed is off-pump CABG. So again, in another study, 1,200 patients undergoing off-pump surgery, and we found a satisfactory calibration and discrimination power in this off-pump CABG patients. But one of the most common complication of off-pump surgery is converting them into on-pump. So in our study, the incidence was around 6%. And look at the mortality. The mortality increased from a successful off-pump, 1.5, to straight away 15%, that is 10 times in converted patients. And this Euroscore helped us to discriminate that which patient is going to be converted to on-pump CABG. The other important risk factors were pulmonary hypertension and mitral regurgitation of any severity. This is another important paper from Nizam's Institute, Hyderabad, and they also studied more than 600 patients, both CABG and VAL surgery patients. And they said that calibration of Euroscore 2 was good, and discrimination also was good. And this discrimination was particularly excellent in VAL surgeons. This is another study from New Delhi, Max Heartcare Institute, and they utilized other three risk scoring systems, and they used their unique Max hospital database, and they said that Euroscore 2, their conclusion was that Euroscore 2 is probably not the best of scoring system. Our neighbors, Bangladeshi patients, they undergoing off-pump CABG, good number, 865 patients, and they also found that this Euroscore performed significantly better. So there was this meta-analysis published of 22 studies involving almost 150,000 patients. And they said that the overall performance of this scoring system and accuracy is good. It definitely does better than the original or the log score system. And they tried to, because as cardiac surgery has evolved, the mortality has reduced. So the risk in high-risk patient is slowly coming down. So which was the patient which was predicted as high-risk probably is now considered as moderate risk. So their prediction is better. And Euroscore 2 is acceptable to contemporary generic cardiac surgery model. So what we understand from all these factors is that Euroscore 2 and STS score it is satisfactory calibration power in Indian patient. But some of the studies have shown good discriminatory power and some of the studies have shown poor discriminatory power. So why this has happened? This has happened because the mortality risk prediction is not perfect in high risk surgical categories. And the high risk surgical categories are probably the one where we need to accurately assess the risk, and that where it matters the most, these scores probably don't do the best. Okay. So, and as far as the STS score is concerned, it is not very well validated in Indian patients. So there is a definite scope for improvement in applying Euroscore 2 and STS scores. What we can do, the best thing that we can do is we need to urgently form a national database where all our patients, there are risk factors which are unique to Indian patients. Rheumatic heart disease incidence is very high. Our patients are very small. The incidence of anemia is very high in our patients. The facility of very high-end gadgets is limited in our setup. So we have to consider all these factors. And if we form a national database for Indian patients, we can definitely do better with our patients. We can predict better and we can ultimately give better quality care to cardiac surgical patients in India. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Deepak, for finishing your topic within the stipulated time. Can I request Dr. Arun Maheshwari to invite our next speaker? In the meantime, we projected the result of our first poll, and I think almost 50% of our listeners are PG residents in anesthesia. So I expect more questions and more grilling from the audience. Dr. Arun Maheshwari, please.
Thank you. Our next speaker is Dr. Vijay Shetty. He is speaking on beta blocker. He is speaking on beta blocker in the perioperative period because some controversies and some recommendations is being generated, particularly for the non-cardiac surgery. Dr. Vijay Shetty, please. He's a head at Fortis Moland Hospital in Mumbai.
Thank you, sir. Maheshwari, sir, for the kind introduction. May I request all the delegates to please put the mics on mute? My topic for today is a preoperative. Start my. Beta blockers, controversy, and recommendations. I bring you greetings from Fortis Hospital Mulund. This is the topic for today. Is the cardioprotective effects of beta blockers applicable to all non-cardiac surgical patients? That is what we're talking about. Non-cardiac surgical patient. This is the patients with cardiac surgery, cardiac defects who are coming for. So I bring you greetings from Fortis Hospital Mulund, which is a tertiary hospital in the northern suburbs of Mumbai. Why beta blockers? Because as we all know, the cardiovascular complications are responsible for approximately half of the mortality that is experienced by patients undergoing non-cardiac surgery. For example, the world estimates that 200 million patients undergo surgery, out of which 10 million are going to be having a bad route there. And out of that, majority of the complications are because of cardiovascular complications. And if you had a vascular surgery or if you had existing cardiac disease, the mortality is as high as 6%. The mechanisms for having adverse cardiac, especially if there's a atherosclerotic plaque rupture, or there may be mismatch between myocardial oxygen supply and demand. And the recent studies have shown that perioperatively, the oxygen supply demand across in the heart is the most important rather than atherosclerotic plaque ruptures. This is exactly where the beta blockers come in, and that is what was proposed. That because of the negative chronotropic properties and the ability to lower the myocardial oxygen demand, they would be the ideal additives to have around the perioperative period. But there are multiple challenges in evaluating and comparing these beta blockers. Among these are various risk factors The type of beta blockers is not standardized. That there are changes in the surgical stresses across various different surgeries that we do. For example, you can't compare an orthopedic surgeon stress with a vascular surgery or with a major thoracic surgery. There are cross disciplines involved. There's risk stratification modifications. And every anesthesia or anesthesia team has its different armamentarium and protocols. More importantly, the existing comorbidities like hypertension, diabetes, ISD, renal. So I'm going to take you back to the 60s and 70s where a beta blocker made its entry. That was propranolol. It was used extensively in prevention of ischemic heart disease or in treatment of heart failure and so on and so forth. And this beta blocker is deeply ingrained in our psyche. And this was supposed to be the diwar between any adverse cardiac events, even in normal life. So this is a famous scene in the movie Diwar, and I want to introduce Mr. Don Paldemans, who is one of the main actors in this whole guidelines issue. And he was the one who was responsible for the decrease 1 to decrease 4 trials. And he was so powerful, these recommendations that were coming out of these trials, that the ACC, AHA, the EHA, everybody said, and the Canadian societies implemented the guidelines or suggested guidelines as per whatever the decrease 1 trials say. So he kept on asking, Keith, mere paas ye sab hai, tere paas kya hai? And that he ran until he ran into Mr. Poise, who gave the answer that mere paas Poise hai and Erasmus trial. So what are these Poise and Erasmus? So let's start from the beginning in 1996, which is about the time that I entered anesthesia. This is a big, huge topic that ACC, AHA guidelines had come. I'm sure that students are still tormented about memorizing ACC, AHA guidelines as they keep evolving out. And in 1996, it was proposed that continuous use of beta blockers in patients who are undergoing treatment with beta blockers, you should continue, and that they may reduce myocardial ischemia. 1999 was when Don made his entry. Don Paldemans in New England Journal, the RCT, said that he gave a beta blocker to 112 patients with positive dobutamin stress, that means high-risk patients undergoing a high-risk vascular surgery. And there he said, because of my administration of beta blocker, which is bisoprolol about 30 days prior to the surgery, at least 30 days prior to the surgery, there was remarkable 91% decrease in the high risk of death and cardiac events in this high risk population. Very remarkable. It was so impressive that the 2002 guidelines said very clearly, they give class 2A, that is, it is very reasonable and almost insisting on its use in whenever the preoperative assessment, the anesthetist identifies a patient who has got coronary artery disease or coronary artery disease risk factors, for example, treated, untreated hypertension, insulin, and so on, obesity, OSA, and so on and so forth. After these recommendations, beta blockers were very widely used in the preoperative optimization strategies. Not until 2008 when the POISE trial came and the adversary came up on the Lancet, and he said in his RCT, there was increased mortality with beta blockers. We'll talk about it in the next slide. Don, not to be undone, he came back with a decrease 4 trial in 2009. And he said, in my first decrease 1, I had talked about high-risk patients. But actually what happened, even in the intermediate-risk patients, there is a 66% decrease. So he refused to give up. Who was on the opposite side? The noise about beta blockers, damage caused by beta blockers was made by 2005 by Lindenhaus, who said the beneficial effects of perioperative beta blockers were only in high-risk patients, but not in low-risk patients. And by the time the 2008 POISE trial came, this noise had come to a crescendo. He said very clearly in the POISE trial, what they had done is that it was RCT, and one of the biggest RCTs consisting of 8,351 patients, in which the patients were separated into getting beta blockers or not having beta blockers. And the ones who had beta blockers were given over 30 days slowly, the bisoprolol was given. And he found that cardiac death, non-fatal MI, non-fatal arrest were all reduced as expected. But what was noticed was there's increased all-cause mortality, stroke, hypertension, bradycardia, and infection even. So the bad phase of beta blockers was suddenly unrevealed, as it were. 2008, also in the Lancet, Bangalore and colleagues also said, and they commented, the decrease on findings are unremarkable. That means too good to be true. And his analysis of 12,000 patients in which the decreased trials were excluded showed a 27% increased risk of mortality when perioperative beta blockers were instituted. The same thing was proven by Bowery and colleagues in 2014. And it is around 2011, the Erasmus, where the original Don studies, where the Paldemans studies were done, they said very clearly the data of the decrease 4 trial is fictitious. And thereby, the whole image of reputation of the decrease trials it was discredited. And often the guidelines mention them, but they don't include them in the final guidelines. So much was the pressure on the ACC, AHA, and ASA that they had to issue the new guidelines. I can just run through a few important points. First, that the one which has stood the test of time is that if the beta blockers are going on, please continue them. And the class 3, there's harmful recommendations was given that you do not initiate high dose beta blockers without titration. It is not recommended. And also do not give beta blockers in low risk surgeries. So this was one, and that only class 2B, that is, it may be given guideline was given for patients with ischemic heart disease and who had high risk, more than 2 or 3 RCRIs, which I come to in the next slide. The which beta blockers to be given, only the ESC or ESA guidelines said that you could probably think of giving atenolol or basoprolol as the first choice if you need to be given. The ACC, AHA are also on the similar lines. They prohibited starting a beta blocker just before the surgery. This is what they said. That means a patient who had more than two RCRIs probably is a candidate for getting the beta blocker. Otherwise, we should not be giving the beta blocker. The 4 observational studies, which were very nicely elucidated in this beta blockers in non-cardiac surgery in the BJ about a year and a half back. There are 4 papers which were reviewed. This was because there was still continuously because the beta blocker was so much in our psyche that we always look at the good points of the beta blocker, but we sort of did a blind eye to the not so good parts. So Lindner, I can just run through this. Lindner and colleagues in 2005, they did the cohort study across 329 patients. You can see it's a mixed group population. London in 2013 did it in the veterans hospital. So you could expect most of the patients would be adult, elderly males. Anderson did the cohort study was a Danish study with all his patients were IHD, having ischemic heart disease. And Jorgensen did a patient in uncomplicated hypertension, simple patients who were taking antihypertensive. And they were divided into patients who were given beta blockers and who were not given beta blockers. And what did we find? On the risk analysis, what we found was this. As for the overall estimates is concerned, you can see the quantum of the risk or the benefit is on the line, on this side of the line. These are the patients or the quantum of risk was reduced by beta blocker. And this was reduced only in London study or mostly in London study where elderly male or the high risk males were present. And what about the RCRI? And just a revision of what RCRI is, a revised cardiac risk index. I think all our need to know about this. This is a simple calculator available. High risk surgery, history of ischemic heart disease, history of congestive heart failure, history of cerebral vascular disease, history of treatment of insulin, and preoperative creatinine more than 2 mg/cent. Meaning, are all these risk factors equivalent? So this is what was tried to be told here. So you can see here in the Lindner study and even in the London study, if the patient had no RCRI or none of these factors or he had one risk factor, administration of beta blocker is actually harmful. As the risk factors kept increasing, the advantage of beta blockers administration perioperatively was unveiled. This is what was given. The other important in this analysis came about is that if your patient had ISD, the benefit was good. But if a patient had ischemic heart disease as well as a history of heart failure, it is probably excellent choice to give a beta blocker. But if a patient only had uncomplicated hypertensive, is a young hypertensive taking a beta blocker, the risks are much higher in a patient who's getting beta blocker and he's uncomplicated. That means if the patient had no risk factors or less risk factors, a simple uncomplicated hypertensive, it is probably not a good idea for the patient to be on a beta blocker. That was what was very clearly elucidated. Also, it brought to the point, that we have not investigated patients who are simple, only a high creatinine, or only who are diabetics. These kind of patients and their benefits or the damages that a beta blocker can cause was not very clearly explained. So we just want to know, does the type of beta blocker matter? Because you can know the beta blockers are, they can be beta 1, beta 2 non-selective, they can be selective beta blockers like atenolol, basoprolol, the most commonly used are probably alpha back. And you know that beta 1, beta 2 receptors are the present beta 1 in the heart, beta 2 all over. And unlike what we normally think, the beta blockers are not only important for cardiovascular function, but also functions of multiple systems, including immunomodulation and it's in the liver, spleen, vascular resistance, everything. The beta receptor actually is present. So does the choice of beta blocker make a difference? That was another controversy that was there. The only study I could find was this beta blocker subtypes and risk of perioperative adverse. This is a large Danish study in which they decided to see what are the beta blockers going on and how are their major adverse cardiac events should these patients undergo surgery. And they found that most of the patients, 60% patients getting metoprolol and 10% carbidolol, 10% atenolol. And they found that irrespective of which beta blocker is going on after adjusting for the rates, they found that they didn't differ in any analysis as far as the type of beta blocker was going on. That means the risk of acute cardiac injury or major adverse cardiac events remained the same. So the choice, that beta blocker probably did not make such a big difference. One more thing, I just want to see how the thinking is changed is the sepsis. You know that in the sepsis, the patient is in sepsis may often be on inotropes and vasopressors. And in most cases, even if the patient is in beta blocker, they get automatically ruled out because patient is getting inotropes and vasopressors. And obviously nobody would be giving a beta blocker for a patient who is struggling to maintain his BP. So it was thought that some of the bad outcomes in beta blocker studies was because of sepsis and the all-cause mortalities. And the thought was given whether beta blocker actually modifies the normal response that the body has in sepsis. Does the beta blocker help to conceal the signs of sepsis? Does the hypertension by beta blocker lead to gut ischemia and therefore worsening of the sepsis? But see how the thinking has evolved. Nowadays, if you see the papers, you will find that the people are actually asking for beta blocker to be given in septic patients once you stabilize by giving inotrope vasopressors. Controlling of tachycardia with a beta blocker is thought to be having better outcomes, or at least they're showing a more positive. So how can this be? Here we are trying to reduce the amount of beta blockers, and there the septic patients where it has not been considered, the beta blockers are thought to be considered because the beta blockers do have an advantage of protecting the heart, say from a very high catecholamine toxicity. It might lead to cardiomyocyte toxicity, fibrosis, stress ischemias, increased calcium intercellularly. It might lead to pulmonary edema because of the relocation of the fluid into the lungs, coagulation problems, immunomodulation, very commonly hyperglycemia we see. So the beta blocker might be helping after a patient is optimizing sepsis. So this is the thinking that intensives can do. But I just wanted to give you that controversy, not only in the CVS field, but also all over. Do we withdraw it? Now that we know that the beta blockers are dangerous in low risk patients, do we withdraw the beta blockers? The clear answer I would say at least is no, because I've not withdrawn a beta blocker. We can lead to angina, can lead to unnecessary tachycardia. These are not the things that we want to know to have in a patient. Also, there is increased platelet aggregability and overshoot of the baseline values. Remember that after patients with beta blockers, there is increased sensitivity to the beta receptors. That means anything you add will be more sensitive. So the receptor numbers and the sensitivity change after you give wrong turn. There is also recommendation not to change the type of antihypertensives. But still, nowadays the beta blocker won't be probably the first choice of when the patient is on is diagnosed hypertension. Stroke was one of the important themes of discussion when the POI study came about. But in Don Palderman, in his defense, I'd say in 2009, before the Erasmus Commission came up, he had written this beautiful article in Anesthesiology saying why the stroke was high. He went on to say that the general surgery, the stroke risk is quite low. And most of what we know about stroke is from CVT surgery, like was mentioned in the previous talk. And the 60% of these are embolic or they're a mixture of hypoperfusion and embolic. They're present early and late fibrillation. Late presentation may be because of atrial fibrillation, coagulopathy, and MI. So the risk factors of non-cardiac surgery, however, is not known well. Is beta blocker one of them? That is what was asked by the POI trial. Don Palderman felt, and many felt, that in the POI study, which was damning for the beta blocker, the amount of metoprolol given was extremely high. It was given very near to the surgery, about a day prior to the surgery, and some patients got about 300 to 400 milligram of metoprolol in a couple of days. So significant hypertension was to be expected, and where significant hypertension is present, obviously stroke would not be far behind. And this was the defense that was given. So I'll just skip this one. I also want to talk about the upcoming trend that we as NSRs will monitor in the coming years is the myocardial injury after non-cardiac surgery. Just because a patient didn't have ECG change or echo change or he went off okay, doesn't mean that he didn't have any myocardial injury. The large international prospective cohort trials showed that myocardial injury after non-cardiac surgery, it's actually mnemonic, is known as MINS, the MINS, is not uncommon, and it has got a very high 30-day mortality also. That means if you detected it by doing a peak troponin T and within the first 3 or 4 days, you could probably send him with the ASA or aspirin or statins and post-op counseling, or maybe even an anti-10A agent. And this is an important thing that's going to come up. I just wanted to present this slide to show that any patient presenting with tachycardia is probably bad news. So unexplained tachycardia is probably, for me, more dangerous than somebody with a little elevated blood pressure. So in this study, this is a controlled vision study, they said that when they analyzed it, they found that a heart rate of over 96 was associated with the myocardial injury after non-cardiac surgery. So probably it's a warning sign. The same study, however, also says that just looking at the heart rate and trying to control it is probably not a good idea. It would important to see if that heart rate is increased because of systemic inflammation, inflammation, or as a reaction to whatever the surgical process that is to be done is, or stress or whatever. So just controlling the rate is probably not a good idea. So what should you do after knowing all these things? If the beta blocker is going, please continue in the pre-op and the post-op and start it as soon as feasible in the post-op. Don't think of stopping it, definitely not. Avoid initiating beta blocker, especially high dose, prior to surgery or after a surgery, definitely not on. Beta blocker is desirable in patients with ISD and heart failure. Maybe if you had a patient with ISD and heart failure, probably you could recommend a beta blocker or tell your friend or your cardiologist or your physician to think about the beta blocker. Do not administer the non-esmolol beta blocker, or at least be very careful when you administer it. Intraoperatively, I noticed that a lot of people like to give beta blocker with good effect too. But in beta blocker naive patient, it can be dangerous giving an intravenous beta blocker. Controlling tachycardia is good, but do not be too aggressive because it has its own ramifications. Whenever we come across patients in whom this might play, the importance of monitoring of heart rate, blood pressure is there. Institute an appropriate monitor. This is, at least this message goes across, that do not be shy of instituting invasive blood pressure monitoring in susceptible patient, because your best chance of picking up falling blood pressure or falling heart rate is the invasive continuous blood pressure monitoring. Have reasonable targets. Don't have impossible targets. Have reasonable targets and have interventions planned. A good plan of anesthesia and plan management is probably better than any other drug that can happen. For importance, for example, we do not measure our correct preoperative BP. We have no idea what the correct preop BP is. So these targets actually have to be given. For example, if a patient has got high BP, you would want to know, is the patient got a bleeding risk or does he have organ perfusion risk? And based upon that, we can have a BP, higher BP, allowable BP, low BP, allowable BP, and so on and so forth. So measuring the BP becomes very important. So in conclusion, I'd like to say the beta receptors, their distribution and their regulation change with disease. For example, acute heart failure, chronic heart failure, sepsis, the beta receptor sensitivity and the distribution changes. The scope of the adrenergic system goes well beyond the cardiovascular system. That is very important for us to understand. The beta blockers themselves are varied according to the act. Changing behavior, that what is there in our psyche, that may be more difficult than anticipated. Common sense should rule rather than overwhelming rules. That how these rules have fooled us for some time in between. So I would say common sense and then overwhelming rules guide the anesthesiologist in the real world. I thank you very much for your kind listening in this hour. Thank you very much, Dr. Kanchi sir, for this opportunity to speak at the ICA.
Thank you, Vijay. It's very nice presentation, covered all aspects of beta blocker. Questions
can unshare your screen. I expect all panelists and speakers unmute their. Do we have Dr. Kritika Anand?
Kritika, has she joined? I have no idea.
Don't see her.
No, we're not here.
Doesn't matter. It doesn't. Okay. We'll see if she joins. Let her join. Otherwise, we'll.
Yeah. Okay. So, nice presentations from all the speakers. Very crisp. Thank you, Vijay, also for a difficult topic. Always confusing topic. Thank you for presenting in Bollywood this time. There are a few questions. I expected more questions, but there is one question from Dr. Minati for Shraddha.
Yes, I read that question on Addisonian crisis CPD.
Yeah.
However, sir, I did reply to her that I do not have any personal experience with the same. I hope that more experienced anesthesiologists on a panel would be able to comment on this.
Yeah. Thing, sir. Okay. So, Dr. Minati, anything on this? Any experience about?
I can say a couple of sentences on that. Can I do that?
Sure, sir.
With the permission of the moderator, Addisonian crisis during CPB can occur. There are case reports, and it is to be diagnosed when you have profound hypotension which is not responding to high dose of vasopressors. The role of corticosteroids to be given as prophylactic agent is highly controversial. You can prevent it by giving preoperatively or just before bypass is controversial. It's not universally practiced. I think Minati is going to speak on that. So whatever I can talk, say on that. I'm just saying. So the use of corticosteroids is a bit controversial. So the treatment is basically corticosteroids and management of hypotension. And the differential diagnosis will be the vasoplegic syndromes, which can occur in some of these patients, especially in NYHA class 4 patients who are in chronic heart failure, or patients who are in amiodarone or multiple vasodilators, they may have vasoplegic syndromes. That is a differential diagnosis for Addison crisis. Now, Binathi, if you are available, you can unmute and say what you would like to add to the knowledge. Is Binathi available?
Dr. Binathi, your mic is enabled.
Dr. Binathi, can you...
Please enable your mic, please. Unmute yourself.
Yeah, can you speak?
In the meantime, Shraddha, I'd like to ask you, do you have a protocol of using hydrocortisone in all patients undergoing who are put on CPU?
Sir, we don't use hydrocortisone for adult cardiac patients. For pediatric patients, we do use methylprednisolone, 30 mg per kg, prior to bypass.
Okay.
But not routinely in adult patients.
Not routinely.
That's right.
Dr. Neeti yes. Mukhija there? Yeah.
Yeah.
What's your normal practice about corticosteroids on the pump?
We use methylprednisolone 30 milligram per kg in the time of going on cardiopulmonary bypass in selected cases, not in all the cases. In selected
all cases.
Okay. Yeah, selected cases where we are going on DHCA or something of the sort.
Okay.
Previously, the use was more, but over the years, the use has cut. We have curtailed the use of steroids.
Excuse me, sir. If I may add, I had mentioned it in my
bypass. Basically, empirical, but there are no controlled studies or evidence to prove that it is efficacious. But we do use it in all pediatric patients, as Shraddha told, also before instituting deep hypothermic circulatory arrest.
Yes, sir. As I had mentioned in my presentation, as per the recommendations, high dose dexamethasone for lung protection, yes, is recommended, but not otherwise, not prophylactically. It's not recommended in adult cardiac surgeries.
All right. Is Binathi there?
Binathi, can you say what you wanted to say?
If Dr. Binathi is not there, can I ask yes. Dr. Shraddha and panelists?
Yes.
Yes.
There's recently technology like Cytosorb has come up for as anti-inflammation.
Sir,
yes.
That's a leuco.
So,
yes.
So they say that it's been added to cardiopulmonary bypass and inflammatory response become lesser. So it has started including an FDA to include for reducing the inflammation on CPB. Can panelists or Shraddha can give some view on this?
I'm sorry, I haven't.
Yeah, Shraddha first, after that I will add some comments.
Sure, sir.
Yeah. Cytosorb and these filtration devices have been introduced especially in patients who have sepsis to remove all the vasoactive substances, especially the cytokine bomb, to remove the cytokines and reduce the inflammation. They have been recommended with reasonable success. In cardiac surgery, especially if the bypass time is prolonged, or if the patient is a very high-risk patient, in those patients, the use of Cytosorb can be considered. But in routine practice, I don't think there is a role. Only in a long CPB procedure or high-risk patients, it may be beneficial to remove the products of inflammatory mediators which are released during CPB using Cytosorb.
Yes.
That will be my comment on that.
Okay.
If I may add, sir.
Arun, do you have anything else to say on that?
No, it's a thing which has been coming up. What you rightly said that it's used extensively in dialysis, nephrology, sepsis. They are using a lot for
especially for sepsis. Sepsis to remove sepsis. All the cytokines. There's a storm in sepsis, cytokine storm. So they remove the cytokines using this.
Vijay, are you using it?
We leave it only for our iris transplant patient who are some sort of a one, and also otherwise they are have a very stormy. We use it. That having said, it is not totally supported. A lot of evidence, like sir said, and also it is probably that the evidence has been built upon as we go along.
Right. Vijay, there is a question for you from Dr. Jayaswal.
Yes.
She asked that young hypertensive role of beta blockers in non cardiac surgery.
Yeah, so about hypertension, I just want to say 3 or 4 lines, which I think for young listeners are there. They can know. If a young hypertensive comes to you, probably you have a very good chance of detecting a reversible cause of hypertension, for example, a pheochromocytoma. That is very important. Secondly, if the patients are with hypertension has actually, the risk of having increased fat loss, increased risk of operative event not properly controlled, a cerebral event bleeding, and if it is too well controlled, that we do intraoperatively might hypertension lead to perfusion, especially the heart and especially the kidney. These two organs are always at risk. So the thing that I was trying to tell was that for a young hypertensive, he probably had a very good reserve. It is probably very difficult to create a complication if you are an anesthetist who pays attention to you, to how anesthesia has been conducted, if you institute proper monitoring. So young hypertensives, I don't expect too much of a problem. In fact, the guidelines don't even say that you should postpone somebody who's got a BP, which is 160, 100, 105, also probably could go ahead. Only if you have a BP of above 180 and diastole more than 110, clearly you should say no for the surgery and go ahead. Otherwise, you can still go ahead with the surgery and not expect any extra complications in even a little older patients with a lot of uncontrolled BP.
So Vijay, what is your best drug to control? What is your favorite drug for intra-op rate control? Is the question somebody is asking, sir?
For rate control? So I am not a big fan of rate control. I think that the rate is a reflection of a few things. Either it's because of light anesthesia, increased CO2. If we control these things properly first, by giving good opioids, good depth of anesthesia, maybe there is a leaking sevoflurane rather than something that you might be thinking. So we should look. Our anesthesia is the best drug for controlling BP and heart rate. That was you only taught me that. So I still follow that, and I think it is important for all anesthetists to remember that the best drug is anesthesia. Only when anesthesia fails, you go for these beta blockers and the remaining stuff to bail you out. But if I have a problem where I'm optimized well, then probably I will I would like to use Esmolol, short acting, and otherwise small boluses of metoprolol is what is usually available in our OTs.
Okay. Any special precaution for low ejection fraction patients for using beta blockers?
I am to answer that. So yes. In low ejection fraction patients, unless the patient is already on a beta blocker, probably is not a good choice to give a beta blocker. What I'm trying to say is that anesthetists cannot be physicians. We do not start a medicine because we cannot follow up on it, and we just it's not a correct thing to start a beta blocker and say isko le lo abhi and we'll see how the operation goes, because the patient will continue that in the after we not titrate it to an effect. So I would rather not start it on beta blocker, though many of our transplant patients who are very 5%, 10% EF also on beta blockers, and they do pretty well because a lot of things get pretty much optimized with the ACE inhibitors, beta blockers, and so on and so forth. So I don't have an easy answer.
Can I add a couple of?
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Can I add a couple of points about anesthesia and hemodynamics?
Sure.
It's not evidence based, but the thing is, when I was working in Nizam's Institute in Hyderabad, the cardiac surgeon would walk in after the anesthesia is induced and patient is stabilized, and on a daily basis, the heart rate used to be about 60 to 65 in all patients. It was, for some reason, it used to be between 60 and 70. And every day he used to ask me, why is the heart rate low? And my standard reply was, the heart rate is on the lower side because of good anesthesia. So I reiterate your point that good anesthesia is absolutely mandatory requirement to maintain the hemodynamic. That is observation, not this one. The other thing is, I also tell my residents that the best antihypertensive intraoperatively is propofol. Use propofol if the patient is hypertensive on table and you checked all the factors you have mentioned about hypercarbia and oxygenation, acidosis. Already you have checked depth of anesthesia is good. Still the patient is hypertensive. Use a bit of propofol. That is the best antihypertensive, which certainly gives satisfactory results straight away. Thank you for that.
Dr. Niti Mukheja, anything you want to add?
No, I also second Dr. Muralidhar, and
thank you.
We have also used propofol at times when boluses of propofol for the control of pressures, high pressures.
So you're following it with depth of anesthesia monitors in all your patients?
Yeah, we have the best monitoring for all the theaters.
Okay. So there is one more question on the CPB. Shraddha can answer that. Are you using pulsatile perfusion, especially in CKD patients, routinely?
No, sir. We don't use the pulsatile perfusion. However, the thing with pulsatile perfusion is that there's no clear definition of it. It is not clearly defined what pulsatile perfusion is. Because it doesn't depend on the pressure gradient. It depends on like the energy gradient. So
anything given in the guidelines, new guidelines on the pulsatile?
Yes, sir. The 2019 guidelines do say that renal and lung outcomes are better with pulsatile perfusion.
Okay.
These are based on several RCTs that have been conducted. However, pulsatile perfusion requires a modification of like the conventional pumps, or it requires that the venous drainage is reduced a little, or we use an IAB. So,
okay. Anyone else? Really... Anyone else using pulsatile perfusion CPB?
Not really, but it is supposed to be good in pregnant patients.
Yes.
But frankly, we have not used it, and the evidence is equivocal. The results with pulsatile and without pulsatile, non-pulsatile, the results are similar. So there is no strong class 1 year recommendation for this.
Yes, sir. It is a class 2A recommendation. Exactly.
There is no class 1 year recommendation, and also there is a fear of more trauma to blood. Hemolysis may be a little more than with non-pulsatile. So pulsatile works well in most of the situations. So we are not using pulsatile perfusion in our patients.
All right. Deepak, don't feel neglected. You're asking a question.
This is Kritika here. I would like to ask a question to Deepak.
Hi, Kritika. Yeah. Welcome.
Hi.
Welcome to panel.
Welcome, Kritika.
We're waiting for you.
Oh, no, I've been actually, I think I was part of the other group in the Zoom since I didn't participate in the dry run. I'm sorry about that.
Oh, so, okay.
The question I had was, we do use STS scores here all the time. For me, having practiced both in India and here, we need to consider the frailty index in the Indian population. It's not the same as the population in the US or the Americans.
Yes.
We don't have the same nutritional status, and how you alluded to, we don't have the same, anemia is more in the Indian population. If you were to design a study and try to come up with a scoring system in India, it definitely needs to integrate the frailty index. Or is work already being done on that? Do you know of any literature coming from India on those lines?
Deepak, you can answer that.
No, I don't think at present there is literature available. But there are studies available as far as anemia and transfusion is concerned in Indian patients, and we have actually, our group actually has published it in JCVA, and we clearly came out that it is more of a transfusion which is problematic than anemia. So it was a small group, 50 patients, rheumatic heart disease, but still the incidence of anemia was very high. Almost 60% of our patients coming for rheumatic heart disease, cardiac surgery, were anemic. So that's a very significant number. And none of the scoring systems actually consider anemia as a risk factor. So probably STS incorporated.
Can I add one point here? Can I say something?
Yes, sir.
Very well said, Kritika. The sterility index, it might have to be included. So our patient population is a bit different from what you see there. Our patients, especially if you take the CABG, they're at least 10 to 20 years younger, and they have more diffuse disease, and there is more of inflammatory event rather than lipid disorder in these patients. And the other difference, major difference, is that most of the CABGs in India are done off-pump. At least 70 to 90% of them are done off-pump. So whether Euroscore is applicable to on-pump is a big question mark. And some of our workers have studied that. And I think Deepak mentioned that in low-risk and moderate-risk patients, it is reasonable to use Euroscore, but in high-risk patients, the mortality rate is about twice what you see in Western population. So we are actually developing a score which is suitable for Indian patients undergoing off-pump CABG. This is a specific group of patients who are undergoing off-pump CABG in India or Indian subcontinent. There we are also looking into the, probably we'll be adding the diameter of the vessels, because diffuse disease is a problem here. And also sometimes we are not able to graft all the vessels. So the number of grafts given also will be included. So we are looking at it in a very close manner. It will take about 1 year's time for us to come up with some sort of a, result. Thank you for that question.
And then one thing I want to add is it's the resources are definitely much higher here for the high-risk population. We do have assist device when they don't come off pump flying, we put them on ECMO. We have impeller device to assist the ventricle for temporary period, or we put the VADs at the end if they don't fly, or they stay on ECMO for a little bit, come back to the OR and get a VAD. So the mortality that we are talking about is definitely going to be significantly higher in India because of the resource distribution, which is very different.
Thank you. We do use ECMO, post-cardiotomy ECMO, if indicated that the surgeon is happy with the surgical procedure and there are no residual problems in the patient. We do use take requests to the ECMO, especially in younger patients and suitable cases. So, yes, we do use.
So
and in patients, especially our results have been very good.
Yeah, Deepak.
That's why in my talk I specifically mentioned these scoring systems can help you appropriate referrals. Centers which uses. So if we identify patients which, like, if we set a boundary for ourselves, okay, this patient we can't handle in our setup. So it's always a good idea to send those patients to centers like Narayana Hrudayalaya or those where the facilities are easily accessible.
Thank you so much.
Yes. Most of the studies that Deepak you mentioned in your lecture were all retrospective. Are there any prospective studies now directly focusing on Euroscore and the risk going on or available?
Unfortunately, not that I have come across.
Our 10,000 patient population will be retrospective. We'll be analyzing. We are actually doing the. We'll be doing the analysis and 10,000 off pump cases.
All are retrospective. That's what.
It will be retrospective.
Yeah. Okay. Anyone else has any questions for the speakers? There is one more, Deepak, for you. Euroscore doesn't classify severity of lung disease, which may have impact on mortality.
Yes, definitely.
Your audio is not
the
very
factor good. And of yes, no, you have to keep it little bit concise as well. So the STS score, which has lot of detailed discussion on every risk factor. So if you try to fill it for yourself, you will feel exhausted at the end of filling for one patient. So the applicability also should be looked into. But unfortunately, the detailing also is, you have to keep a balance between the two. And Euroscore doesn't mean...
It includes chronic pulmonary disease on steroids as one of the factors.
Okay. Yeah, Dr. Kritika, anything to add?
No, I think that was a great discussion on it.
Thanks, Pujani. Vijay, just one small question for you. Anything to do or anything written in the guidelines about anemia and beta blockers? Because we have a lot of patients coming in for surgery who are preoperatively anemic. So any relation to low hemoglobin and giving beta blockers or not giving beta blockers?
Actually, I don't think that will gel. But one, it's a very important point, sir, because acute or chronic or sudden hemorrhage or even chronic anemia, both of these have to be treated very, very carefully, because especially now since we are having a more tolerable, tolerating even lower hemoglobins in our population, how much is enough? How low is enough? That is one. Secondly, when we have tachycardia secondary to anemia, the tachycardia has to be controlled by correcting the hemoglobin rather than the hemoglobin. That is an important lesson that should go as well. And third is that low hemoglobin itself is a risk factor for all those adverse outcomes that has been blamed on the beta. So when we are comparing studies, most of the times they don't write about how much bleeding was there, what is the preoperative hemoglobin. Those things are never mentioned, and that is why the real relationship between pre-existing comorbidity and the outcome is can never be proven. So we're just thinking one drug is causing an effect, but this is not the right thing to
There was a question from audience, probably for Vijay, I think. The things are like patient low EF, hypertensive.
You already answered that, sir.
Low EF. Hypertensive with low rate. What antihypertensive is of choice?
So in the intraoperative period, we would probably go for infusions of vasodilators. But as you say, this patient, I would expect this patient to already have a lot of lines in, and probably if it's a cardiac, even the transits will echo to begin. So titrating something, but I would still go across to see if my anesthesia is working properly, because the ability of a heart to produce such a high blood pressure is probably abnormal. Overload or a catecholamine surge that is happening because of some abnormal. I'm going to temporarily, because I just want to temporarily see if I can control it. But balancing the upload contacted is what we do. We need to do it after input from various devices and monitors.
This is you talk a lot about non-cardiac something about the cardiac area from panelists and others. Are we really modifying these drugs in our preoperative period, or we are giving the dose that the patient was taking regularly?
I guess
this question is to whom? This question to panelists, and because this is a general question that in cardiac surgery, we have a lot of patients who are on beta blockers, and are we modifying the dose preoperatively, or we are giving the same dose?
The general guidelines of preoperative medications are equally applicable to cardiac patients, beta blockers, ACE inhibitors, digoxin, or diuretics. The same general rules will apply. if the patient is already on beta blocker, it has been monitored. All the anti-angiogenic and anti-hypertensive medicines are continued till the day of surgery. But as the guidelines point out, beta blockers are not given on the day of surgery if the patient is not already on beta blocker.
I was asking about the dose. Suppose patient was taking 25 metoprolol. Are we 100% supplementing the same dose on the preoperative dose, or we are
same dose?
Same dose.
Same dose.
Yeah.
Same dose. It will be same.
Is it a general view for all, or some panelist can add something? Related to
No, panelists are most welcome to answer, but I would say that whatever guidelines are there for patients, it is applicable both to cardiac and non-cardiac patients as far as preoperative medications are concerned.
I'll agree to that, sir. What sir said is absolutely correct. Line that is there somewhere in the ESA is that if the patient had hypotension detected on the day of the procedure, probably you could reduce the dose. That is been mentioned. But I think... In our current working scenario, that might not be very appropriate. Like I said, if we have enough monitoring, probably we could start enough medications to increase or reduce the BP intraoperatively. So that's the only line that I think, Vaishwari sir, which can add up to what sir said.
Okay.
I would like to add that patients undergoing, you did mention that there are a lot of off-pump cabs in India, but here most of often than not they are multivessel and it ends up being on pump. It is a quality index for us to continue the beta blockers, and even if they are not, they are started in the perioperative period during the assessment of the patient, working them up for the surgery because of the lower incidence of atrial fibrillation that these patients can develop in the post-operative period. That's the only thing I wanted to add.
Thanks. I guess with permission of Dr. Kachi Mulidhar, I think we are already overshot. I can see Sunny is there waiting for us, probably telling us that we are overshot the time.
It's my pleasant duty to thank Uday Gandhi and Arun Maheshwari for having conducted this seminar so well and successfully. I am indeed indebted to them. And I would like to thank Niti Makheja, Prithika Anand for joining us. And I must congratulate Shraddha, Deepak and Vijay for their excellent presentations. I really had a lovely time listening to them. And I think the dinner is waiting for us. It will be virtual though. Please join us. And we will meet the next Wednesday for the next lot of ICA webinar. And thank you so much. I really love
this session.
Very well done, Vijay and Deepak and Shraddha. Very well done.
Yes.
Thank you so much for being with us.
Thanks, Anish. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much. Niti was my co-panelist. Thank you so much.
Yeah, thank you so much.